Hi, I'm Dr. Fasano from the Center for Celiac Research and Treatment at Massachusetts General Hospital in Boston. Our center that was established in 1996 was the first one in the United States, and we've been living the history of celiac disease in the making ever since. Of course, you know, as everybody knows, the treatment of celiac disease remains the cornerstone of the gluten-free diet. We were under the impression that this was, you know, the best treatment possible. It still remains, but it's not as infallible as we believed before. We learned this in the hard way over time, thanks to the fact that scientists and patients together were able to work out, you know, the path that brought us to knowledge that were unthinkable only a few years ago. Now we have a much better understanding if, why, and when somebody is genetically predisposed to celiac disease will develop the condition. And we also know that, unfortunately, the gluten-free diet is not as infallible as we believed before. Therefore, thanks to this new knowledge, complementary and integrative treatment to the gluten-free diet has been, you know, explored since 2005. There was a landmark in which we reached the critical mass of knowledge to allow us to eventually explore alternative or integrated treatment to the gluten-free diet. This goal could not have been achieved without having the dedication and the involvement of thousands of people affected by celiac disease that stepped up to the task to really to help to fuel this new verge of knowledge that are now the basic for, you know, the new hope, the new frontier in terms of, you know, the management and understanding of celiac disease. There's been recently a flow of emails and bloggers in which there's been some criticism or raised some concern of, you know, re-exposing somebody with celiac disease to gluten because this is part of the research that is needed really to move the field forward. Beside the fact that a few years ago, for diagnostic purpose, the gluten challenge was the landmark to really confirm the diagnosis of celiac disease, and therefore has been done as a standard care for many, many years. More than 6,000 people during the past 10 years have been re-exposed to gluten as part of these studies with no major consequences. Thanks to these heroes, we really reach unthinkable results in terms of knowledge and therefore the possibility to move the field forward. Ongoing research is necessary really to achieve, you know, the next step on knowledge, and the only grail goal that we have to improve the quality of life for people with celiac disease and their families. Therefore, this is not a scientific exercise. This is on something that we did do lightly, but is a necessary step really to bring to the table knowledge and therefore additional information that will be instrumental to achieve this overall goal to increase the quality of life of people with celiac disease. I thought that it was necessary to put, you know, this information out there and to set the record straight that doing a gluten challenge not only is, you know, not dangerous, not have a long-term consequence of people with celiac disease, but because we don't have an animal model, is the only way to really make progress and to really move the field forward. This was the fact before, just for clinical purposes. This is the fact now for research purposes. Nothing changed and never will change in this domain in terms of, you know, helping us to help you as a celiac. I thank you very much for your attention, and I hope that this clarified this misunderstanding that's been floating around for the past few days.